At the time I will be fixing my second lecture, I will be sharing my second lecture screen. So let's take a couple of minutes break. I request Professor Dan to please provide a couple of minutes.
Thank you for the first presentation. And you continue the analysis of micro enterprises, I think, no? With some challenges. You may continue, but please, 25 minutes.
Yeah, I'm trying to share my second presentation. So within a couple of minutes, I will share. Yeah.
Close the first presentation.
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Can you see my screen, Professor Dan?
Yes.
Okay. In previous presentation, we saw the importance of microenterprises in mountain economy. But establishing micro enterprises or promoting micro enterprises is not that easy. It's not a cakewalk. There are several challenges we need to understand. And in this presentation, I would like to highlight those challenges, which I have witnessed practically in mountain areas while working in all these 8 countries and some parts of Central Asia also. Let's try to understand these challenges faced by micro enterprises. So different categories are put in presentation. So let's start with financial constraints. So as I mentioned, in mountain areas, limited capital available for investment because of low productivity and income. Mainly agriculture and non-agricultural activities, mountain area subsistence. So food is being produced for own consumption. And if some of the economic activities are being the non-agriculture activities, it's just to fulfill the basic requirements of household. So business point of view or proper commercialization point of view, our goals are not actually visioned in mountain areas by communities. So mostly the reason is one, they have marginality, they have inaccessibility, limited access to market, and high transportation cost, transaction cost, it's difficult for them to bring their products to market. So gradually, with the passage of time, over the decades or centuries, mountains, agriculture and non-agriculture activities confined to subsistence. Excuse me. Because of all these elements, limited capital is available with farmers and communities to invest in productive economic businesses, particularly in micro enterprises. Another constraint, inadequate supply of financial services due to inadequate network of branches of financial institution and several risks associated with the supply of financial services. For example, in financial institutions, no financial institution prefers to lend money, disburse loan or financial services to areas or communities which may face high risks. So what financial institutions do in most of the cases, they cover their risks through insurance. But in mountain areas, unfortunately, insurance companies are also facing some source of risk, whether that may be because of natural hazards or climatic hazards or even socioeconomic shocks may result in cost to those insurance companies. That's why mostly insurance companies are not that much interested to cover the risks of damages caused by climate induced or natural hazards. If those risks are not covered by insurance companies, it's very difficult for finance loan disbursing financial institutions to disburse loans. In such case, it's very difficult for mountain areas to have adequate investment capital to start a micro enterprise. Then technical constraints. Of course, in mountain areas, inadequate supply of technologies we are observing, particularly in developing countries. Even as I mentioned, agriculture is mainstay in mountain areas or mountain economies. And most of the agriculture in mountain areas is traditional. Very less mechanization, very moderate or limited invasion of technologies in mountain areas. Relatively low capacity and skill of local labor force. As I mentioned, youth, they prefer to out-migrate to other areas. In that case, older population or women, they stay in mountain areas. This is what we have observed in our region. And old population and women, mostly elderly women, they don't have technical skills or capacity to adopt to technologies related to financial services or other services. Relatively, and let's go to the next point. Then inadequate capacity of enterprises. Of course, whoever wants to start business in mountain areas, agriculture, non-agriculture, need to have some exposure, some skills, capacity to start that business. In mountain areas, it's very related to previous point. In mountain areas, entrepreneurs don't have adequate exposure to technology, skills, and business management. And mostly universities and educational centers or professional training centers are concentrated in plain areas. And market constraints, mountain areas are distant, physically isolated in most of the cases. Why I call it physically isolated? Very poor road access, rail connections are not there in most of the mountain areas in developing countries. So farmers or non-farming entrepreneurs, they don't have access to market or collection centers. This is a big constraint, which actually hinders the establishment of micro enterprises, or start of micro enterprises in mountain areas. Then physical challenge, of course, terrain, topography is very important challenge. So because of topography, it's very difficult to produce tangible or non-tangible products or services at scale. It's very difficult to attain the economies of scale. Transportation and transaction costs are high, as I explained in my previous slides. So another thing, movement, rapid movement is very difficult. For example, if some products in mountain areas are having very small shelf life, so because of terrain, it may take days to convey or transport that product to processing units. So that is another constraint why most of the areas are not having investment in terms of micro enterprises. Then inadequate physical access or physical isolation, as I mentioned earlier, it's linked to our point, which I explained on market. And environmental issues, mountain ecosystems are highly fragile. We all know, very vulnerable to droughts, floods, gloves, landslides, debris flow. And sometimes it becomes very difficult to find a safer place in mountain areas to establish a business point. There are several areas, as I mentioned on 21st, one of our colleague delegate Prakashji, he presented on the viable solution on the early warning systems for landslides. Yeah. So in that area, after presentation, I mentioned there are several areas, particularly Sindhupalchok district of Nepal. If we go the upper parts of Sindhupalchok, highly vulnerable to landslides. it's very difficult to find a safer place for evacuation, safer place to establish business points. Even agriculture fields are on top, but very vulnerable to landslides also. On several locations, we saw that agriculture fields are eroded by landslides. That's why it all matters, because whenever financial institutions, they want to disperse loans or financial services, or insurance companies, they want to expand or supply their financial services like insurance. They consider all these aspects. They also consider the weather conditions. They consider the level of risk. So because of mountain fragility in mountain ecosystems, it causes difficulties for them to make decisions. The limitations in policy environment, mostly in mountain areas, or for mountain areas, policy instruments are very inadequate. Mostly policies are generic. There are exceptions. Some countries are fully mountains like Bhutan, or 80% or 83% of Nepal is mountainous. But policy, so several, most of the countries, not most of the countries have both plain or mountain areas, and but policies, programs, and strategies are very generic, and mountain specific instrument and policies are not establishing overall guiding documents. That also push back. If credit program or prudential regulation on credit are established, they are generic. They do not take into account mountain fragilities and challenges, as I mentioned earlier. Then natural shocks, of course, earthquake is one of those natural shocks in mountain areas. Many investors or even local farmers, if they want to establish micro enterprises, they take into account all these risks, including natural shock. Natural shocks is very rare. Earthquake does not happen every year, maybe after decades, 50 years, or even after centuries, but it's always in mind of people in mountain areas who are living in seismic zones. If they invest something, if they invest whatever they have saved whole of their life and earthquake happens, it's gone. So it's always risk for them to invest in mountain areas, especially in seismic zones. Other issues very related to our environmental aspects, fragility I discussed. It's several times it happened in mountain areas, particularly in Afghanistan and Pakistan. I would like to give example from Balochistan province. Drought, very prolonged spell of drought happened from 1999 to 2003 in Balochistan province of Pakistan. So in that period, millions of livestock died or affected, and thousands of hectares of agricultural land was turned into barren. And because of this shock, and millions of people, they had to out-migrate to other areas. Another example in flood-prone areas in Himachal Pradesh and central Himalayas, for example, in Nepal, parts of India and Pakistan, very vulnerable to bluffs. Bluff happens very frequently nowadays in recent decades. Roads, bridges, and infrastructure is damaged, and it leaves people under shock. Price shocks. They are disconnected from other areas, and locally available food is very limited because supply chains are disrupted from plain areas to mountain areas. They face price shocks. We call it economic shocks because of these economic shocks also. The fear of these economic shocks is always in mind of investors, even local investor or external investor. Then what solutions? Some of the solutions are the instruments I have put. I can tell confidently that these solutions are not enough to go with all those challenges I have presented. So it can mitigate the risks or mitigate the challenges, but challenges will remain in mountain areas. So always there are risks, and there will remain risk in mountain areas. But in business and economics, always there have to be tendency to be a risk or to take risk. There is no business without risk. So let's start one by one how we can cope with those challenges. planning the micro enterprises according to local agroecological conditions and climatic conditions is very important. If some business is started and that business depends on the raw material coming from other areas or from distant mountain areas, so that will not be sustainable. It will not run longer time. So always it's important to assess the local potential in, as I mentioned in my previous presentation, assessment of local context and agroecological condition is very important. So assessing local agroecological potential, for example, if some area is having potential in food production, nut production, or traditional crops, based on that local potential, if any enterprise is developed, that will actually be sustainable. And similarly, climatic conditions are also important to be taken into account. And more attention to localized micro enterprises very close to supply points. If micro enterprises, for example, processing units or storage facilities are established very close to production points, that will be more sustainable. As I mentioned in my previous point, even within mountain areas, if processing unit is established far from 10-15 kilometers from the producing point, that may face challenges. Farmers will also be a transportation cost. 10-15 kilometers is so long in mountain areas. Then paying more attention to environmental friendly micro enterprises is very important. As I mentioned, mountain areas may have competitive advantage, may not have comparative advantage. And organic and clean products are one of the features which produce competitive advantage for mountain products. So it's important to pay attention to environmental friendly micro enterprises, or we can call these organic, clean, or green, based on the local term being used by governments. And providing adequate climate services is very important. As I mentioned in my first point, knowing climate conditions is very important in policy instruments or in implementing framework. It's always important to consider climatic conditions and to ensure the supply of consistent climate services to entrepreneurs. When to rain, if some hazards are likely to happen, some forecasts, some early warning systems, always important to relocate or to prepare for those. Providing incentive mechanism by government is also very important. Those incentive mechanism may include subsidies, credit, insurance facilities, or technical support, pricing mechanism. In pricing, some support prices are for raw material, or support prices for, we can say, the floor prices for the producers also, if some mechanism is established for floor prices for producers and ceiling prices for the consumers, it will benefit both producers and consumers. Overall, it will benefit the micro enterprises. Paying more attention to youth and women is also very important. And women-friendly technologies or micro enterprises are very important. And those enterprises where youth can contribute, that is also important. As I mentioned, youth are out migrating from mountain areas. They pay more attention to other opportunities. It's always important to provide them incentives for startups, for in the form of subsidies or technical support or training or capacity building packages, important. Use of in-cash or in-kind remittances for microenterprises. In mountain areas, a lot of inflow of remittances. Remittances may be used in a productive way, more efficiently in establishing micro enterprises. If in cash remittances are limited, even in kind remittances can be used. In kind mean the people who out migrate to other areas or other countries, they build their skills with the passage of time because they work in several places, they study in good quality universities. They can use their skills. So we call those skills or technical advancements, which we acquire with the passage of time as an in-kind remittance in mountain areas. So that can also be used. And ensuring no harm to local environments. So if, for example, some micro enterprises are established, those enterprises may not harm the local environment. No degradation of natural resources, more focus on organic production, and more paying due attention to local diversity. It's also important. In several areas, micro enterprises are established. They are contributing to local income, and farmers or non-farmer producers are very happy that their income has improved. But in overall food systems, sustainability is very important. If sustainability is compromised through the decline in agrobiodiversity, if some enterprises established on fruit, vegetable, for example, potato, all farmers are likely to shift from diverse agriculture systems to potato. In the short run, in financial terms, it will benefit them in terms of economic returns or income. They will be happy, prosper, but it will add to their insustainability, vulnerability, because they will be highly dependent for food and non-food items on external food supplies. So in case of hazards, they will be dependent on external food. They may be pushed to transitory food insecurity after every couple of years, because in mountain areas, hazards are very frequent, which break the connectivity of mountain area from other areas. Another thing, losing agrobiodiversity in mountain areas has long-term impact on sustainability of food system. So it's always important to take these aspects also into account, overall long-term future sustainability of local systems. So one example from the Hindu Kush Himalaya region on enterprise. So I will call it resilient enterprise. Let me see the time. How much time, Professor Dan, how much time we have?
4 minutes.
4 minutes, okay. So one of the enterprise in that area established in Gilgit-Baltistan, which had very inadequate access to market, other institutional services, farmers were niche farmers producing at very micro scale. One factory, micro enterprise was established by one of the person from the area, the same area. It employed 10 employees. That factory actually started processing the locally produced fruits, nuts, and it benefited around 1,000 farmers. So in that area, post-harvest losses were very high, around 30 to 40% for vegetables and 22 to 60% for fruits. That only one unit, one micro enterprise established in that area, it benefited 1,000 farmers. It resulted in increase of farmers' income. That unit did not actually hamper the local diversity and ecosystems also. They prefer to buy organically produced raw material, and they do not have any impact on the local resources degradation. Diversity of agriculture systems is maintained. They reduce the transportation cost of farmers also. It's a kind of win-win situation. Microenterprise is earning very good business from that area, and similarly, farmers' transportation and transactional costs are also reduced. Their income has increased. So it's a good example. I saw this example in my previous visit in 2019 in that area. I will not go into detail because we have less time. So I will call it resilient microenterprise because it contributed to economic returns to farmers, very significant increase in their income, and it did not hamper the local systems, local agricultural systems and ecosystems also. Agrobiodiversity is maintained. This microenterprise was established based on the local agroecological potential. It did not promote that in that area, okay, you grow XYZ products. Whatever products are being grown, they establish microenterprise based on those local agroecological potential. So it also contributed to Yeah, I think I have covered these points. The local food security to improve income, overall food security is also improved in that area. Not only because of the value addition of products, the enterprise diversified the final products. Now, a lot of people in that area, in that village, are consuming locally produced value-added products, jam, jelly, juices, and all that. It improved their diversity, dietary diversity also. On the other hand, it improved income of people. Overall, food security of people in that area improved. And a very important point, nuts and fruits are less vulnerable to climate change in that area. It means before establishing that micro enterprises, the person who established, he did proper assessment, agroecological assessment in that area. They planned micro enterprise around fruits and nuts, and fruit and nuts are more vulnerable. In that area, we had survey and we published one study also. So farmers, they report, majority of farmers, they reported in changing climate, changes in temperature and precipitation patterns are resulting in improved productivity of fruits and nuts in that area. So it shows that proper agroecological assessment was done before start of that enterprise, micro enterprise. So I will call it resilient micro enterprise. It contributes to all three dimensions of sustainability also. With this, thank you very much. Let's take 2 minutes break and I will set up my another presentation.
Thank you. अब आधा घंटा देखते हैं.
So can you see the screen, Professor Dan?
Yes. And try to.
Yeah. I am trying to. I am trying to put it in presentation mode. Yeah.
Try to finish in 25 minutes, please.
Okay, I will try to finish.
Thank you.
Let's start on the linkages of microfinance and microenterprises, very closely linked. As I mentioned in my first presentation, it's not always necessary that microfinance is linked with microenterprise, but it's always plus point, particularly in mountain areas where people don't have adequate financial capital to invest. So if microfinance is linked with microenterprise, it's always a plus point. So first, why financial services are important in mountain economy? So it's a kind of repetition from my previous presentation, of course, because of low productivity and income and high risk involved in production or production systems, and to incentivize use, in economics term, we can say use the available human resources efficiently. It's important to have financial services for efficient use of natural resources also, like land, water, forest, and minerals. Then integrated growth, whenever we introduce microenterprise model in mountain areas, it does not only focus in one sector or subsector, it involves multiple sectors. For example, water, clean energy, agriculture, health, all sectors are involved actually. So microenterprise establishment actually is a triggering factor of integrated growth. Okay, types of financial services required for mountain areas. So financial services are not only limited to supplying loan or supplying money. So there are several types of financial services which are important for mountain areas or entrepreneurs in mountain areas. First is financial literacy. Awareness of local people how to use loans, remittances, or insurance services are saving in a productive way. And another thing, overall banking and institutional financial services, mostly in mountain areas, Even conventional services, financial services are very limited. So all type of conventional or unconventional financial services are important. Then credit and loan, it's also important, only one small part of financial services. As I mentioned, financial services include loans, credit, remittances, insurance, and saving, and some other services are allied extension services also. So credit is only one part of that. Loan is also one part of that. So loan and credit is also required in mountain areas. Insurance facilities, of course, very important to cover the risks for loan or credit providing institutions, because they have to cover their risks also. And then facility of saving account. So one thing is important actually here to explain why I have put this point. There is difference between credit and loan. Loan is a kind of amount. For example, $100 I want to give to another friend. He borrowed from me $100. He promised that he will return after 2 months. So when he borrowed from me that $200, so from that day, the interest rate will apply. So he will return me with the interest rate, right? That full principal amount, $200. Credit is little bit different. Credit is line or limit. I give $200 to one of my friend, I give him line or limit. So he can repay $100. I am giving the extreme limit. So he cannot cross $200. So I am giving him a condition that, okay, you take $200 for 2 months and you can make transactions. Sometime you can deposit $100, you can return, and again you can withdraw, but you cannot cross $200 limit. It's a kind of running account under the ceiling, under the line. That is credit. Mostly we can see credit cards, so we can deposit also outstanding amount, principal amount, and so we can withdraw, but we cannot cross one limit. It's a running account. Similarly, in running finance, so we provide a limit, and under that limit, transaction can be made, sometime deposit, sometime withdraw. But in loan, it does not happen. Loan is, once it's paid, so that cannot be adjusted. If it's adjusted, it's adjusted. The withdrawal cannot happen. So, so that's why always it's important to have current or saving accounts for credit or financial services to make transactions. Sometimes they can deposit and sometimes they can withdraw. It reduces the amount of charge interest. Whatever is withdrawn or outstanding credit, or sorry, markup or interest will apply to only that amount. It will not apply to full amount. Then remittance transfer. So for inward and outward remittance transfer also, this is also kind of financial services, is very important in mountain area. As I mentioned, around 40% households in our region, HKH region, Hindu Kush Himalayan region, have out migrants who send remittances. So it's always important to include this also in overall financial service package. Let's try to understand the difference between microcredit and microfinance. Microcredit, as I mentioned, very small credit line or credit limit provided to those people who want to start any business or enterprise or for any other development purpose. It's always associated with interest rate, but occasionally or in rare cases, it may be free of interest also. But mostly it's associated with credit, with interest rate. Interest rate is also called markup in some of the countries. In some of the countries, it's called repo. No need for physical collaterals. Mostly in conventional credit, we have to provide some property. We have to provide some land holding as collateral. So bank mark their lien or mortgage on that property and disburse the amount of loan. But in credit, no collaterals are required. Against personal or group guarantee or social guarantee, microcredits are dispersed. Mostly microcredit schemes, they include men, women, differently able people, or vulnerable groups. And it's very inclusive. mostly in microcredit, short-term capital needs and repayment plans are considered. But in microfinance, there are three points very different. Microfinance is credit plus. As I mentioned, not only the amount, credit amount disbursed, also the allied service like deposit accounts, deposit on maybe saving account, maybe current account, insurance facilities, remittance, receiving and outward remittance facilities and all that. That will be called microfinance. Another difference in microfinance, long-term risks are considered. Whether this person's business will be successful or not, whether he will have repayment capacity or not. So all these things are considered. It means in microcredit, short-term needs are addressed, but in microfinance, long-term needs, long-term well-being and long-term repayment capacity and long-term risks are considered. And in microfinance, social mobilization is also one of the part. We can also say that financial literacy, a lot of mobilization or convincing of people are done that how to use this loan, how we can use this loan more productive way, what are the repayment plan, and of course, business accounts or saving accounts are also provided in that package. So they make transactions, sometimes debit, sometimes credit transaction. All these things are part of that financial literacy or social mobilization. Some of the examples of microfinance institution, Grameen Bank in 2006, the pioneer of Grameen Bank, Dr. Yunus Mandi Nobel Prize. And another example from our region, Akhuvat from Pakistan. So Magsaysay Award, Asia's Magsaysay Award is won by this network in 2021 in current year. If we see the types of microfinance, several types, formal or informal, all government institutions which are established and working under the prudential regulations of central banks, they provide financial services. We call those financial services formal financial services. Some of the financial services are provided by non-governmental organizations or lending agencies, sometimes categorized as semi-formal financial services, or sometimes they are clubbed into formal services. All financial services provided by informal lenders, friends, money, middlemen, or in some instances, provided by agriculture extension providing agencies, also pesticide companies, fertilizer companies, and all that. Those services are categorized as informal services. And some very indigenous type of financial services are also available. Roscas, one example from Latin America, Africa, and Asia. So most of the community members, they have membership, informal membership. They contribute funds in one collective fund. Every month, as per defined amount, they contribute. And one of the members get the amount in 1 month, maybe another member in second month, another member in the third month. So it fulfills the needs of members. So for example, 10 members are contributing 10,000 by each member. So 1 lakh will be the total amount in 1 month. So that 1 lakh amount may be taken in by one member and can be invested in his or her micro enterprise or whatever business he or she wants to do. A similar type of system exists in India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Nepal, in our region also. We call it indigenous contribution system. In local language, we call it committee system. It's actually ROSCA, but different name. Sometime cash plus non-credit services are available. Microfinance is provided in cash with other non-credit facilities like information services or extension services, saving or current accounts. Mostly banks do this. They provide credit in terms of money and they provide associated services that qualify into financial services. Sometimes the credit is provided in kind. All services, non-credit and credit, are in kind. For example, if some institution, if especially non-governmental organizations, they do not pay money. They buy the thing and hand over that thing to the micro entrepreneur. Similarly, based on the number of people who are availing that facility, individual or group, categorized into individual or group-based financial services. Similarly, for government and non-governmental categories, based on whether it's being disbursed by government or non-government. Challenges, there are several challenges being faced by microfinancial services from the perspective of community and institutions also. Number one, high fungibility. If monitoring system is weak or inadequate, or non-credit services are weak or inadequate, there are higher chances of fungibility. Fungibility means spending of that amount or services on other purposes. For example, if I have a well loan or in agreement, I have mentioned that I will use this credit facility or financial facility for agriculture products, I will produce or process this apple, for example, apple. I will process apple and I will sell out its pulp. But I am using that amount for wedding ceremony or social festival, that will be fungibility. And then likelihood on increase indebtedness. If fungibility is high, of course, very straightforward, there are chances of long-term indebtedness of those households which actually use financial services for other purposes. In most cases, in so many countries, several evidences are available that microfinancial services have high interest rate associated. For example, from informal sources, we have witnessed that 40%, 45% interest rate is being obtained by informal lenders from the borrowers. So in such case, there are high chances of indebtedness. Even in formal disbursements also, there are evidences that interest rate is unaffordable for the entrepreneurs. Then, of course, in mountain areas, because of fragility, lack of infrastructure, lack of physical networks of communication companies, and because of topographical constraint, weather conditions, so digitalization is a big challenge, because in most mountain areas, even if farmers don't have smartphone, they don't have network, it's very difficult to digitalize financial services. We talk about mobile banking, virtual banking, payphone. All these services are very difficult in mountain areas, particularly in developing countries. Lack of awareness about clean and green microenterprises and its weak linkage with microfinance. Mostly farmers in mountain areas, they don't have clarity on the concept of clean and green microenterprise. One of our delegates will also present on green economy. We all know that the next stage is of green economy. So it's important to create awareness on green microenterprise and green economy and its linkages in microfinance. See, microfinance is linked with green enterprises. Special schemes are announced in microfinance for green enterprises. That will be very important for mountain area. Of course, another thing, high transaction costs, as I mentioned, microfinance, small amounts, micro amounts. Amounts are very small. Always in banking sector, I served banking sector for 3-4 years on a position, different position. Banks always consider transaction costs. Lesser the amount, higher will be the transaction cost. If I am disbursing 25,000 PAK rupees or Indian rupees to a borrower, my transaction cost is 7,000, 8,000. And there are other risks also, fluctuation in money value and all that. So it's always a big challenge for financial institutions. And in microfinance, because amounts are limited, transaction costs are high, always financial institutions are reluctant to expand, particularly to risk-prone areas like mountains. There is, of course, supply and demand gap. Demand is high in mountain area, but supply is very less. I mentioned the different reasons. I have presented the institutional perspective also. Number one factor is high transaction costs and risk coverage. So what makes financial services, microfinance, attractive in mountain areas? Few of the points I have put. No requirements for collateral, of course, very attractive. Then large and low cost business in mountain area which require microfinance, largely low cost businesses, very less investment is required. Microfinance is also very less associated with other services, so it's attractive. Freedom for entrepreneurs to plan and execute business. They can plan, prepare their own plans for business, but in terms of agreement, they have to mention, disclose, but very less intervention or interference from service providing institutions. So another thing, socially inclusive, so it takes into account all vulnerable groups, including women, disabled people, elderly people, different ethnic groups. There is no discrimination. Even landless, they can obtain because of not requirement of collaterals in microfinance. Then coverage of climate and non-climatic risk. Mountains are more prone to risk. If climatic and non-climatic risks are covered, insurance companies are integrating with financial institutions and these risks are covered, it will cover the risks of farmers as well as the financial disbursing institutions. Then last point, mountain services and ecosystem may also benefit from financial services. So mostly banks, they see the tangible things. For example, what will be the stock? What thing being offered as collateral or as a mortgage where they can charge their lien or they can hypothecate? But in terms of microfinance, it does not require collaterals and it's very suitable for services rendering enterprises. And because it's based on the personal or group guarantee, based on personal agreement, so it's more viable and suitable for particularly service rendering micro enterprises in mountain areas, particularly tourism. With this, thank you very much. So if any questions, I will be very happy to respond questions in Google group. So I try to be concise and provide narrative-based presentations. I did not put a lot of statistics and all that because statistics and conditions, as I mentioned, vary from one region to other region, particularly for mountains. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Hussain. You are working hard. Your mouth is too dry.
Because since morning I had multiple meetings and right after another meeting I had to take this session. So it's my pleasure. It's my pleasure always be very supportive to Grassroots Foundation. Thank you.
Thank you for the interesting aspects about micro enterprises in the mountain area.